This famous cartoon character was created by one of these three men. What is your name, please?
My name is Hank Ketchum.
My name is Hank Ketchum. My name is Hank Ketchum.
Only one of these men is the real Hank Ketchum. The other two are imposters and will try to fool this panel. Tom Poston, Sally Ann Howes, Johnny Carson, and Betty Furness on To Tell the Truth with your host, Bud Collier.
Thank you very much. Welcome once again to Tell the Truth, brought to you this week by Anacin, the headache remedy with a special combination of ingredients to relieve pain, fight depression, calm jittery nerves. Anacin. Well, Sally, Betty, nice to have you both back with us tonight.
Thank you, Tom. Good to be here, Bud.
Good evening, the rest of you panel. Hiya, Bud. Will you open up your envelopes and take out your affidavit cards for the first time and follow along as I read? I, Hank Ketchum, am a cartoonist. On September 11th, 1946, a son was born into the Ketchum family. He became the inspiration and source of material for a comic strip which is now syndicated in over 700 papers here and abroad. He is also the subject of a television series which has been a hit on the CBS network for the past three seasons. I am the creator of Dennis the Menace. Signed, Hank Ketchum. Three gentlemen to start our festivities this evening, and you heard them all claim to be, as I heard them, Hank Ketchum, the real-life father of Dennis the Menace, I guess you could call him. Let's start this first round of questioning with Johnny Carson. Johnny?
Thank you, Bud. Number two, what is a storyboard?
Beg your pardon?
What is a storyboard?
This is where we put in the story after you've drawn your cartoon.
Number three, who is the creator of Dagwood?
Chick Young.
Number one, who is the creator of Maggie and Jiggs?
George McManus.
I'm getting nowhere fast. Number three, is it true that occasionally Dennis's father appears in the strip and resembles the creator?
It is.
So the father in the strip would look like you?
Right.
Or...
Betty.
That got me mixed up, right? A lot, Johnny.
I had a thought there going.
Number one, what is the name of the man who played Mr. Wilson on the television show?
Who played Mr. Wilson?
Played.
That was Mr. Kearns.
Number three, what is Al Capp's hometown?
I've forgotten.
Number two, who originated Maggie and Jiggs? Oh, you asked that one. Mr. and Mrs.
I have forgotten.
You're young, aren't you? number three.
Tom.
Oh, thank you, Bud. Number one, Betty asked a question of mine about Mr. Wilson. Did you mean to imply that two people had played it? Number one?
No.
Would you tell me, number one, where the TV episodes of Dennis the Menace are filmed?
They're filmed on the West Coast.
Do you know specifically where?
At Screen Gems.
Do you know where at Screen Gems?
I don't know. It's in the Columbia Studio facilities, I believe.
Do you know number two by any chance?
It's in CBS Television City.
Number three, what specific area of California are these filmed? Do you know?
Hollywood.
Thank you. Number one, do you normally wear glasses? I'm sorry about the number three, Paul. Forgive me. Number one, do you wear glasses normally?
Yes, when I'm working.
Thank you.
Sally Ann.
Number one, who writes Peanuts?
Mr. Schultz.
And number two, who is Snoopy?
Who is Snoopy?
Who is Snoopy?
Who are?
You are.
I am.
I didn't say it, Betty did.
Number three, which papers abroad in England do you have your cartoon published?
London Sunday Pictorial.
Sunday Pictorial.
Right.
Number two, what is Al Capp's cartoon?
Al Capp is the Labman.
Number one.
That's all the time we have, panel. So we've done rather well here. Some of you act relieved. You don't have to ask
anybody
any more
questions. Anybody think I read cartoons?
But in any event, let's make up our minds now on the basis of the evidence we have elicited. And mark your ballots. Without consultation, will you vote now for number one, number two, or number three? Of course, our team of challengers will get the usual $250 for every incorrect vote. Are we all set? All ballots marked?
I got something.
Okay. Tom, for whom did you vote?
Oh, that's a one. That's a number one. And the reason I asked number one if he wore glasses was because I think he most favors the father of Dennis the Menace, of course, in a stylized way. I mean, he's not stylized, but the cartoon character is. They were all beautifully brief, though, I must say, again.
Sally Ann, your vote.
Well, I vote for number three because he looks so serious. And I think that if anybody laughs at their own material, they'll never get a cartoon done on paper.
Johnny, what about your choice?
I go along with Tom's reasoning. He most resembles Dennis the Menace's father. And number two didn't know the wonderful dog in Peanuts, Snoopy.
Betty.
Yes. Well, I voted for number two. I'll tell you the truth. I didn't know who drew most of those cartoons either that I was asking about. But number two looks like he's the father of some devil, and it could be Dennis the Menace.
Votes in now, and you heard the way our minds are made up, at least. Let's see how whether we can justify them as we learn which one of these three gentlemen is, in real life, the real-life father of Dennis the Menace. So Will the Real, Hank Ketchum, please stand up. Like our two fellas came through on that one. I guess they read the comics more than the girls do.
Yes, I must confess I don't read them.
Well, that'll open up a whole new life for you now.
I will now.
Number two, would you tell us your real name and what you really do, please?
My name is Jerry Amatrani, and I'm an electronic computer salesman for Addressograph Multigraph.
Thank you, sir. And number three, your real name and what you really do, please.
My name is Herbert Haas. I'm associated with America's oldest church-produced telecast, Faith for Today.
Well, we check our score, gentlemen. We find there were two correct and two incorrect. And at $250 each, that's a total of $500 for you, gentlemen, from Anison, as well, of course, as a gift package of the fine products from the makers of Anison. And we thank you very much. Hope you enjoyed your visit. We certainly enjoyed having you here, and we'll read your script with even more interest. Good night. God bless you. We'll meet another team of challengers in just a moment. Now, a word about Anison.
Next time you buy a pain reliever, think. How many kinds of pain? Your husband's tension headaches. Mother's minor pain of arthritis, arising from deep in bones and joints. Your son's aches and muscle strains. For these many kinds of pain, you want the combination of pain relievers in Anison. There's a big difference in Anison that makes a big difference in the way you feel. Anison contains extra ingredients, missing from aspirin, still missing with Buffering. Extra ingredients that make a big difference in the relief Anison brings. Fast relief, without stomach upset. Yes, Anison is like a doctor's prescription. That is, a combination of ingredients for fast, more complete relief of tension headaches. Hours of relief of neuritis, neuralgia, minor pain of arthritis, rheumatism, muscle strain, backache. So for these many kinds of pain, get Anison. The big difference in Anison makes a big difference in the way you feel.
Now let's meet our next team of challengers.
What is your name, please?
My name is William Conway.
My name is William Conway.
My name is William Conway.
Follow along once again, if you will, panel, with your copies of this affidavit. I, William Conway, started collecting turtles when I was 10 years old, and I have been interested in wildlife ever since. Today, I find myself responsible for a collection of more than 3,000 animals. Fortunately, I have an efficient staff of some 300 to help me with the varied problems of housing and feeding. I am the director of one of the largest and most famous zoos in the world. Signed, William Conway. Very well, panel. You've heard these three gentlemen all claiming to be William Conway, director of one of the largest zoos in the world. And we start this cross-examination with Tom Poston. Tom?
Oh, thank you, Bud. Number one, looks a little like Clark Gable, doesn't he? Look at that handsome fella. Number one, when Woody Loper specialized in wildlife, what was his choice, do you know? Besides girls, of course, but I mean in animal wildlife.
I don't know.
Do you know Mr. Loper? Do you know Mr. Loper, number two?
I don't know him.
Number three?
Never heard of him.
Well, tell me, number three, what kind of cats live in old mountains, in mountains?
Which particular mountain?
In the western part of the United States.
I'm afraid I don't know. I'm with the Durban Zoo.
In Africa?
In Africa, yes.
Oh, thank you. Do they have any old mountains in Africa?
They have no cats there.
In Africa?
In the mountains.
Not the kind of cats we have here in the States, anyway. Sally Ann.
That's unfair to come to me after cats, my goodness. Number one, where is your zoo?
My zoo is the Bronx Zoo, here in New York.
Oh. Number two, what is the name of the zoo in London?
It's the Zoo of the Royal Zoological Society.
Number three, what is a red-eared turtle? Where does it come from?
The Galapagos Islands.
Where are the Galapagos Islands from? Where are they?
In the Indian Ocean.
Where?
The Indian Ocean.
I see. Thank you. Oh.
Johnny.
Number two, where do elephants go when they die?
This has been a great question for many years. I suspect they just steal away into the jungle.
Number one, what is the gestation period for an elephant?
18 to 22 months.
Number three, would you agree to that?
Entirely, yes. That is correct.
Number two, what's the difference between a turtle and a tortoise?
Well, it's a rather nice distinction. Usually the tortoise has a much higher carapace.
Has a higher what?
Carapace.
Has a higher carapace.
And shorter legs.
Shorter legs and a higher carapace. What's a carapace?
The top shell of a...
Well, the top shell.
Betty.
Number three, what is an aardvark?
It is an animal which is common in South Africa, with a long nose, about 5 feet, 4 feet, 5 feet long, which digs and lives on ants, mainly.
Its nose is 4 or 5 feet long?
No.
The whole animal?
Nose to tail, yes.
Oh, I see. Number one, in the newspaper within the last 2 days, there was an interesting thought about turtles. What was the news item? Could you tell us very briefly what it referred to? Number
one? I did
not
see it.
Number two, are you familiar with that news item?
I did not see it either.
And that's all the time we have, so none of us will have a chance to see it. We'll have to get to the business of looking over our ballots very carefully and voting. So will you do so now, panel, without consultation, and vote for number one, number two, or number three? Aardvarks all marked.
My carapace is a little high.
All set. Is that everybody? Okay. Tom, which one did you select this time?
I was quite distressed about his answer about cats never being in mountains in Africa, because I remembered Hemingway's Snows of Kilimanjaro, where there was a leopard found, carcass, frozen carcass. Then I realized that was at least some kind of fiction, so maybe he knows better than Ernest.
Sally Ann, your vote, please.
Well, I must say, I did want to vote for number two because I love the way he pronounced the zoo in London. It sort of brought back a few memories. But I couldn't resist those little islands in number three.
Johnny, your vote, please.
What were those islands, really?
I voted for number two because of the difference between a turtle and a tortoise, which has a higher...
Yes, it sure does.
Right.
All right. Betty.
I can say Galapagos Islands, but I voted for number one. Because...
I think he looks like a fellow who could be the head of the Bronx Zoo, that's all.
All right, 3-3, 2-1 we have worked up there, and that's our score as it stands now to see who is right and who is wrong as we learn which one of these gentlemen is the real director of one of the largest zoos in the world. So will the real William Conway please stand up? Thank you very much, Joe. Just to keep the record straight, William Conway is the director of one of the largest zoos in the world, the Bronx Zoo, here in New York City. And he is, in fact, one of the youngest zoo directors in the world. That's quite a job. Busy man. Have to be young, I guess. Let's find out about our other two guests now. Number two, would you tell us your real name and what you really do, please?
My name is Joseph Coolidge. I'm not even English. I was born in Boston, and I'm associated with Be My Guest, an international gift and host service that operates through travel agencies.
Thank you, sir. And number three, you garnered most of the votes. What is your real name, and what do you do?
My name is Brian Winston Lee. I'm First Secretary with the Tanganyika Mission to the United Nations.
And if he can say Tanganyika, you know he can say Galapagos. Let's check our score. Gentlemen, you did better. You were a little tougher on the panel. You had 1, 2, 3 incorrect at $250 each. That means your take-home pay tonight is $750 for you, as well as, of course, from Anderson, the gift package of all the fine products made by that company. Thank you, gentlemen. You gave us a lot of laughs and a good time, and I hope you shared in it, too. Good night, and God bless you. Now, panel, may I present our third team of challengers.
What is your name, please?
My name is Aline Mosby. My name is Aline Mosby.
My name is Aline Mosby.
And once more, panel, may I ask you to follow along with your copies of this affidavit. I, Aline Mosby, am in this country between assignments as a foreign correspondent. I have spent the past 3 years covering Moscow for United Press International. Those years in Moscow were exciting ones. I covered Richard Nixon's trip through Siberia. I was there during the U-2 incident and the subsequent trial of Francis Gary Powers. I reported on the space flights of cosmonauts Gagarin and Titov. I covered Khrushchev's press conferences. He referred to me as one of his Sputniks. I have written a book on my experiences and impressions. I call it The View from Number 13 People's Street, signed Aline Mosby. All right, ladies, you quite comfortable? Ready to play our game? Let's remember for just a moment that we all heard these three ladies claiming to be Aline Mosby, foreign correspondent. And we'll start this round of questioning with Betty Frenette. Betty?
I'm afraid you won't, Bud, because I believe I am acquainted with one of the ladies, so I think I will have to disqualify myself.
Oh, too bad. Well, that will count as an incorrect vote when we come to totaling up. Thank you very much, Betty. Tom?
Thank you. Number one, who is Ted Musel, or Musel?
Foreign correspondent in Moscow.
Thank you. Number two, what is Titov's first name? How do you pronounce his last name?
Titov, that's correct.
What is his first name, please?
It is German.
Thank you. Do you happen to know Gagarin's first name?
Oh, yes, of course, Yuri.
Thank you. Number three, what is the hypnotism controversy over Titov's recent flight?
The hypnotism?
Hypnotism. There's some controversy about whether or not he was hypnotized. Do you know anything about that?
No, I don't.
Do you know number two?
No, I haven't heard of it.
Is that so? Number one?
Nothing to it.
Nothing to it?
Sally Ann.
Number one, who is the correspondent to the White House for UPI? What's his name?
Merriman Smith.
Number two, the name of Mr. Nixon's last book. Number three.
I've forgotten.
Number one, what is the name of the main town in Siberia?
The main city is Novosibirsk.
Number six. Number two, who was first up in space, Gagarin or Titov?
Gagarin.
Number three, number seven, question eight.
Johnny. number two, who was the attorney who defended Powers during the trial in Russia?
Oh, what was his name?
That's what I asked you. We ask the questions here and then you answer. Number one, can you tell me the name of the attorney here in...
Hoffman.
Can you tell me the name of the attorney here in New York who arranged for his release?
Name was Hoffman.
Hoffman?
Hoffman.
Uh-huh. Number three, why did Khrushchev refer to you as one of his Sputniks, as it says here?
Well, the word Sputnik means fellow traveler. And he meant...
Thank you.
I guess that's it. That was a fast round with a lot of laughs, and I hope you had as good a time as I did. But it's time now to get to the business of marking your ballots, so will you kindly do so, panel? Mark them now in English, not Russian. And vote, if you will, for, without consultation, number one, number two, or number three. All ballots marked. All right, Thomas, which one this time?
I was really quite puzzled. I was going to vote for number one until she sort of stumbled on the name of the lawyer. And Mr. Musil is a UP correspondent, but he happens to be stationed in London at the time. Now, he could be ex of Moscow and Russia, but I voted for number three.
Sally Ann, your choice.
Well, I did go for number one. Because she knew the name Merriman Smith, which I didn't think everybody would know. And also, she looks like my idea of a woman correspondent. Is that the right word? Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Hmm. Johnny.
they're all very well informed, but I'm going to go for number one. She seemed to have the most information on this.
Okay, Betty, you disqualified yourself, so that will count as an incorrect vote when we tally up the score. All right, ladies and gentlemen, here we come again to our denouement, so to speak, as we learn which one of these ladies is the real foreign correspondent. So will the real Aline Mosby please stand up? Quickly,
one question. May I ask you, please, the meaning of the title?
Yes,
you didn't get around to that.
I was dying to know that.
Number three? Number six? What's the meaning of your title?
You mean the title of the book?
Yes.
Well, it was the address in Moscow where I lived, and it also was the UPI Bureau. I lived in the office.
All right, let's find out about the other two now. Number one, you got the most votes. What is your real name, and what do you really do?
My name is Jean Spencer. I'm an account executive with Doyle Dane Burnback Advertising Agency.
And a good one, all right. Number two, may we have your real name and what you do?
My name is Jane Levy, and I'm just a wife and mother.
Don't say just a.
Come from Jamaica, West Indies.
That's an important job. Very well, in checking the score, we add, of course, Betty's in as an incorrect vote, and that means for a total of 1, 2, 3 incorrect at $250 each, and that's a grand total of $750, ladies. Not bad for an evening's fun, as well as a gift package from Anderson of the fine products made by their company. We thank you so much for being with us. Hope you enjoy it. Good night. God bless you. Now a word of interest about a new nasal spray.
For sinus congestion and head colds distress, use Dristan Nasal Mist with a decongestant most prescribed by doctors to bring quick, deep relief. Look, the nasograph shows almost no air through this victim's nostrils. Now, Dristan Mist sprayed into one nostril. In seconds, it penetrates deep into swollen nasal and sinus passages, promotes drainage, thus relieves pressure, controls post-nasal irritation. Now, nostril sprayed with Dristan shows free breathing restored. Get Dristan Nasal Mist.
Well, I'm afraid that's all we had time for, but it always goes too fast for me. Good night to you, panel.
Good night.
Good night, Bud.
Bud Collier saying good night from Addison and reminding you to tell the truth. Good night, everybody.
And now a word about Santa Claus.
If you hate to scrub that bathroom bowl with cloths, cleansers, and bleaches, you need Santa Flush Bathroom Bowl Cleaner. This beaker illustration shows how Santa Flush cleans the modern way. In minutes, its chemical boosters remove dingy film that forms in any water, even dissolves hard water rust ring. Cleans brighter because it contains the stain-removing chemical sodium binoxalate. Pour, let stand, swish, flush. It's no work at all with Santa Flush.
To Tell the Truth is a Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production. Tell the Truth has been brought to you tonight by Dristan Nasal Mist, the new decongestant spray for relief from miseries of sinus congestion and head colds. This is Johnny Olson saying goodnight for To Tell the Truth. This program was pre-recorded.